I'm going to make the presentation in English because we have a guest here, our international guest Claudio, and I believe that we have to be inclusive community, so I'm going to present so he can understand us too. Otherwise, it will be a little bit of a dick move if I just speak in Bulgarian. All right, what is automation? Automation is something that was mentioned quite a couple of times during the presentations today. And Claudio was speaking about misconceptions. And one of the misconceptions that we can hear very often is that automation can replace human testing and that automation can replace human. Automation of any kind can replace humans at all. And this is something that is due to probably the fact that many people understand testing as something very simple and something very easy. And we are actually, as a community, suffering from a disease called tools and practices. Every time you go to a conference or you go to an event or you read a blog post or a book about software testing, somebody is explaining you how to use a tool or how to perform a practice. And we are not focusing a lot about the intelligence that we are using when we are performing software testing. So my topic today is a little bit more about what we are doing as humans, what we are doing as software testers that make us so special that we are almost impossible to automate, we are almost impossible to be replaced by either automation or either artificial intelligence, because that's the big topic that goes right now. Everyone is like, artificial intelligence will replace everyone. We are going to be ruled by robots and Skynet and stuff like this. And every time that I hear something like this, I'm like, are these fucking guys on crack or something? Are they high or something? Because we don't have any practical evidence about this right now. There's some masterpiece code, pieces of code that are performing AI, but we don't have anything close to intelligence. So I'm actually going to challenge the intelligence part in artificial intelligence. So, who am I? I am the guy on the picture. I am software tester, I am a blogger, and I also am a lecturer in local academy called Pragmatic. And that's everything that you want to know about me. I won't brag about any of my achievements or how many years of experience I have. It's just irrelevant bullshit. So, a short story about how people are going to be replaced by robots in pictures, because this is not a new trend. This is something that probably exists since the beginning of the century or the previous century or whatever. It's not a new topic. Well, the first time that probably people started to speaking about replacing humans or human testers with the automation was probably when unit testing came to existence and developers are already happening to write automation code and perform some sort of testing. So somebody said, well, we can get rid of these fucking testers. They're only creating problems for us and they're only giving us trouble. But it didn't happen. We still have testers and they are actually an integral part of performing software development. So the next time that this happened was probably when a lot of methodologies appeared. And practically any new methodology that appears comes with the notion that it will minimize the number of defects and it will maximize quality and it will make the existence of software testers almost the work of software testers almost none, so we don't need testers anymore. But this doesn't happen again. It didn't happen for Agile, and now DevOps comes with the big promises, and this doesn't happen in DevOps as well. So we have our personal favorite, the UI automation. When automation appeared, everyone was like, yeah, we can just automate everything. You know, we have something moving on the page by itself. You don't need testers anymore. You can just have automated tests to do it. But we still have testers and they still don't exist. And of course, my personal favorite is artificial intelligence, because nowadays everybody's speaking about artificial intelligence. And they're actually very enthusiastic about it. They treated it like this huge, ununderstandable entity, but it's almighty, and we are almost treating it like God. And the fun fact about artificial intelligence and the talks that I'm listening about artificial intelligence, that they're almost based, always based on something like science fiction, like speculations, like something that somebody reads somewhere or watched a movie or whatever. So my reaction when I see something related to artificial intelligence and how it's going to replace testers is just, no, it just won't happen. Do you have some sort of practical understanding about what we are doing and what we are performing right now? So if you are speaking, yeah, by the way, I mentioned the artificial intelligence couple of times. So if there is none of us who understand what artificial intelligence is, I will have to skip to Bulgarian a little bit for quick to give a short definition about artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence значи човек, който парадира с интелект, ама не е точно. Това оказа анонимността ни богатка скоро и в този ред на мисли искам да кажа като муканина, Боже, много, колко изкуствен интелект има по този свят, Боже. Claudio, you won't get this one because it's a cultural reference, but I'll explain it to you later. So, perfect for our industry and for any industry, because IT industry is acting like any other industry, is to have production line workers, because production line workers are something that's easy to measure, easy to control. They're normally performing this sort of very easy to track actions, very easy to produce and reproduce, and they are very easy to measure and understand, and very easy to replace. Very easy to replace by robots, any kind of automation, any other human being or person, and mostly very easy to replace by non-qualified personnel. If you practically perform something that doesn't require thinking, it's very easy to replace by anyone. So, what the key point of this lecture is to, if we have really the battle, it's not a battle, it's not happening right now, but if we have a battle between us and the machines, what can we bring to the table and what can we say about our job that is so important that cannot be automated or cannot be replaced by artificial intelligence? I'm going to focus on a couple of key topics, like two or three, and the first one of them is social. So the social nature of testing. That's something that we don't hear and see spoken about at conferences because, as I said, we suffer from this disease about tools and practices. And after all, we have to realize that what we are producing just as a software development company is not just code. I think it was Kem Kaner who made this analogy that saying like, what we are producing is just lines of code, instructions to the computer that are operating in a specific manner is like saying that a house is just a pile of bricks which are ordered in a specific way. But that's not true because a house is a place when somebody has to live. House is a place when somebody has to feel at home. So it's not just a pile of bricks. It's something that brings pleasure and brings satisfaction to someone. So the same way, our software that we are producing is something that has to bring satisfaction to someone using it. Try to think of an activity that you're performing normally in your life, like going to buy groceries or going to buy an airplane ticket. You're speaking with a human, you're receiving some sort of satisfaction about the service that you're getting. So it's the same with software. You have to get that same feeling from the software. So we're not just producing code, and very often we are operating with notions like quality and risk, and these are notions that we cannot codify because they are human notions. We cannot simply try to transfer them and translate them into bits and bytes. We can fool ourselves that we can understand what quality is if we are measuring stuff like number of defects closed or a number of test cases run, but we cannot actually understand what quality is because quality is something that matters to someone, as Jerry Weinberg said. And last but not least, what we're producing like software is something that has to solve some social problem, something that exists in the society. Just like money. If I just take a piece of paper and I write 1 million leva on it and I give it to Netco, for example, will you feel like a millionaire? No? Why? Yeah, they're fake. Why are they fake? Good one. Yeah, they will be fake. Why would they be fake? Well, because nobody trusts what I wrote on that paper. But whenever we have a currency, whenever we have money, they are actually something that is approved by anyone. They have some sort of social meaning. They have some sort of cultural and social value. And that's the way that money operates. If we just grab our money and we send them into the space and aliens from other civilizations come and get them, they won't matter anything to them. It's just the pieces of paper, unless the paper is very limited resource on their planet. But what we are performing also has some social value. And if we grab the social value and remove it from what we are performing, and we just grab the action, they cost nothing. They're just something that we are performing like actions. So the next thing that I'm going to speak about is actions. It seems very easy if we just try to imagine this picture of, if we just grab a tester and we record all the actions that he's performing and we try to translate them into machine language and try to feed them into artificial intelligence algorithm or machine learning or neural net, it will probably work to produce some expert testing. And this is actually the thing that we try to produce with record and replay tools. But it didn't happen. Why didn't it happen? Well, it turns out that human actions are something very tricky. And I want to make the difference between action and behavior, because we are almost always producing behaviors. Anything that I perform is behavior. I'm walking down the stage, I'm moving my hands, which I do a lot, so sorry about that. And this is something that we normally do, like a movement, which is involuntary. And we have actions, which is practically a behavior. It's the same as behavior, but it has intention. And intention is something that is very interesting. The better representation I can give about that is like the difference between a wink and a blink. A wink is a behavior. It's something the opposite. A blink is a behavior. It's something that we are performing involuntarily, like closing our eyelids without trying to do it very hard. A wink is something that we are performing voluntarily, trying to, depending on the social context, trying to convey some message. For example, if I'm sitting here and I wink at my friend Netko, he will probably understand it as some sort of, I want to tell you something secret, you know, we both know something that none of the others know, and I'm trying to transfer this way of message. And this is the intention. And intention can be very interesting thing because it can vary based on the context and based on the social environment. For example, if I'm walking down the street and I see a beautiful woman and I wink at her, and it happens that she's with her husband, I will probably not get a friendly response. And this is how intention is involved in what we are performing as testing. And when we are speaking about action, we have two types of actions that are qualified by a person called Harry Collins. Harry Collins has this beautiful book called Shape of Actions. And I will give you links at the end of the presentation about this one and another one, which is also interesting. So he qualifies actions like two big types. One of them is called mimeomorphic actions, and another one is called polymorphic actions. Mimeomorphic actions, a little bit definitions, because these sound like a very mouthful words. What is a mimeomorphic? Morph comes from shape, from Greek, and mimeo comes from mimesis, which means replicate or imitate. So mimeomorphic actions are actions that try to replicate and imitate action over and over again. And we do a lot of this in our day-to-day routines. We perform these machine-like actions. We are trying to perform anything, over and over again. Practically any other action is polymorphic. Polymorphic actions are naturally variable and naturally different. And actually, we as humans are producing polymorphic actions. Practically anything that we perform is polymorphic, and we have to try really, really hard to perform mimeomorphic actions because they are not natural for us. I have a challenge for you. Go to your job on Monday and try to perform something in exactly the same manner that you have to perform it. Write a script about something, about making a coffee or about testing, and try to perform it in the same way, from the same spot, with the same height of the hand, with the same way that you're looking at it. You will see that it's actually very, very hard. So that's something that's not natural for humans. But it turns out that machines are really good at producing and reproducing mimeomorphic actions. So that's a little bit more about actions. Example from our testing career and what we are doing is, for example, when we are performing mimeomorphic actions, we are, executing a test script or executing a test case, because that's something that we want to follow by the point very, very narrowly. But there is polymorphic actions that we are doing that we cannot easily automate. And this is the part when we design test cases. This is the part when we try to explore the application. This is the part when we try to find out more information or come up with new ideas for testing, for example. As I said, humans are naturally variable and we are performing naturally polymorphic actions, while machines are actually very good at mimeomorphic actions. So, it all comes to knowledge. It turns out that actions are not that easy. It turns out that knowledge is something that's important to manipulate. If we grab the knowledge from a human being, from a human tester, and try to switch it into bits and bytes, we can probably produce testing, which is a good idea, but it's also not that simple. When we are speaking about knowledge, knowledge is not actually that linear as we are thinking about it. As I said, normally when we're speaking about tools and practices, we only focus on the execution part, we are only focusing on the performance part, but we are not focusing on the knowledge part. And the knowledge part can be separated into four different levels. And these four different levels have different level of difficulty of automating. And I have these smiley faces right here, which indicate how easy it is to automate. It is, again, a qualification from Harry Collins. It's from a book called Artificial Experts. And we have four differences of knowledge. The first one is facts and rules. Facts and rules are very easy. They're very easy to automate, and we have them all around our software testing projects and our development projects. These are our requirements. These are our acceptance criteria. These are our definitions of done. They are formed like a rules, and rules are very simple to turn into instructions because they are instructions themselves. Then we have the heuristics and coaching skills. What is a heuristic? Heuristics is a way to solve a complex problem by providing a practical solution coming from our empirical knowledge, which means we try to come up with solutions for something that we have already as previous experience. This is something that automation is still not good at, but artificial intelligence is actually pretty good for solving, and it's related to, can you hear me like this? Right. But it's actually, artificial intelligence is pretty good at producing this because they have these neural networks which actually take decisions based on their previous experience. So they're kind of building heuristics. And heuristics and coaching skill are also something that we probably can turn into code if we use artificial intelligence. Both these are forming the so-called explicit part of knowledge. Explicit part of knowledge means knowledge that we can easily make explicit, try to convert it into text, try to convert it into instructions, try to convert it into something that we can transfer. When we are going into a conference like this, or when we are going into schools or reading books, we are actually exchanging explicit knowledge because it's something that we can interchange. But there's another part of knowledge which is called tacit knowledge. And tacit knowledge is something that we cannot transfer very easily. Tacit knowledge is normally not exchanged via learning, but it's exchanged via apprenticeship and via error and trial and error patterns. So we have our manual and perceptual skills. Manual and perceptual skills are something that we cannot translate very easily into code, because they're something that depends very narrowly on the person that's performing them. For example, a katana swordsmith, a Japanese swordsmith that performs, makes katana swords, which are very famous middle-aged swords by the Japanese country, is actually performing only manual actions. They don't use any sort of electronics, they're not using any sort of thermostats, they're performing all these manual actions, and they're actually depending a lot of their senses. So for example, when they have to harden the sword, when you have to take the raw steel and turn it into a hardened sword and start to sharpen it, they have to get it up to 800 degrees. And they are not using a thermometer, they're using only their sight. And they say that the steel has to become with the color of the rising sun, which sounds specific as fuck. But they're having this specific perceptual skill that tells them that the steel is at the temperature that they have to put it in the water and make it a hardened steel. If they go only a couple of degrees above, they can make the steel very cracky, so it doesn't become a sword anymore. Or if it's not hot enough, it will probably get very soft and won't be good for sharpening. So this is a specific skill that we cannot translate into automation. We cannot teach a machine how to perform this because it's very, very strict to the person that's performing it, and we have a lot of this in testing. Also, this is the way that we transfer language knowledge. For example, if I give you a right sentence and a wrong sentence in Bulgarian, you're going to be able to tell what's the wrong one and what's the right one, but you're not going to be able to tell what are the rules that are staying behind this difference, unless you're being into philology or linguistics or something like this. And we are transferring language like this without giving the explicit instructions on how to operate, which we are mainly getting by the last part, which is cultural skills. And cultural skills is something that is almost impossible to transfer into code. Cultural skills is something that is only understood by immersing into a culture or a society. And cultural skills cannot be easily codified because they're constantly changing, because the culture and the society are changing based on the people and the members who participate in the society. And that's the reason, for example, why learning a language is so important when you're going to another country, because you're getting a lot of cultural skills and a lot of social skills through the language. And last but not least is a couple of assumptions that a person called Hubert Dreyfus noted about AI researchers, because we are very big on speaking about how great is AI, and I'm ready to challenge the intelligence part of artificial intelligence. So Hubert Dreyfus challenged a couple of these notions, and he called them assumptions that AI researchers made about the human brain and how human brain operates. And the first one of them is called a biological assumption. So he said that the AI researchers assume that the human brain is sort of working like a computer, that the way that brain waves are operating is like the way logical Boolean gates will operate into a computer, which is a good model. Actually, it's a good model to explain how the brain works, but it's not entirely true. It's not that simple. Compared to our brains, the computers are very, very much more simplistic. And without being a neurosurgeon and without going into any further details, I'm pretty sure that we are still not there to understand how the brains work, because we are still trying to solve problems like how ant brain works or how bee brain works. So we are still not there with understanding how the human brain works. The next one is the psychological assumption, and the psychological assumption is that the mind can be viewed as a device operating on bits of information according to formal rules. Now this sounds really good, it sounds very correct, but a famous psychologist called Daniel Kahneman, and he has a book which is called Thinking Fast and Slow. If you're interested in psychology and if you're interested in things like bias and heuristics, you definitely have to read this book. Actually, he found out that what we are doing when we are thinking and when how our psychology is organized, they identified the two systems. One system is called system one, which is the so-called fast system, which is responsible for taking very fast decisions, but they're normally not based on our logical brain and our logical thinking. And these are the decisions that we are taking under huge stress or when we are trying to save our lives. And there's another system, which is called system two, which is the system responsible for taking very logical and very profound decisions about what we are performing. For example, testing, for example, when we are trying to solve a complex mathematics problem. And very often we are using our system one, and we are not even in control of how to perform an action. So this is not very valid. And the next one is the epistemological assumption, which is that all knowledge can be formalized. What is epistemology? This is a part of philosophy which deals with the origin of knowledge. What is knowledge? How do we know that we know something? And what is truth, for example? So the epistemological assumption is that all knowledge can be formalized, but we saw that this is not that easy, because knowledge isn't just linear, it isn't just one layer. We have different layers of knowledge, and there's part of knowledge that we cannot even express. And the last one is the ontological assumption, that the world consists of independent facts that can be represented by independent symbols. In order to automate something, we have to take a fact, we have to take something that exists in human life, and we have to turn it into a symbol, try to convert it into bytes or into instructions or into text or whatever. But as we saw, it's not that easy to convert something and explain something independently, because very often we are using relations between things in order to explain something. They don't just exist autonomously. So, couple of conclusions that we can kind of draw from what we saw until now. The pessimistic conclusion is that human jobs and the tester jobs will be and can be automated and replaced by AI and automation if we continue to act like robots, if we continue to perform testing like it's just a set of instructions. It's also possible to automate human jobs if we continue to demonstrate only procedures and fail to demonstrate the intelligence part that we are having while we are performing testing. And that's something that Claudio mentioned, that's something that I'm trying to mention in every conference. We are very bad at explaining how complex is our job. Nobody is speaking about replacing developers, because everybody sees developers like these guys with aureoles around their heads, and they're always performing this complex job. But everybody's speaking about replacing testers because testing seems so easy, and we fail to provide visibility how not easy is our job and what complexity our jobs has. The realistic prediction is that we can actually use artificial intelligence and automation as a good counseling service, as an expert counseling service, because we perform a lot of brain work in our testing, and some of this brain work can be cut short because we like to solve complex tasks, we like to solve complex problems, but they're very exhaustive, and we get exhausted. And machines don't get exhausted, which is really cool. So we can kind of pass part of the hard work, part of the heavy lifting to the artificial intelligence and automation to kind of crunch all the information and aggregate it and give us only the important bits of the information. And last but not least, the information, the prediction from my favorite, the testing troll, is that none of this is true. All of this is just a lie. Trying all the automation and AI hype is just a decoy that has to lure us, our attention from the real problem that our job is going to be taken by doggies. As you see on the picture, Oracle are already testing with doggies. So, two important books that might be interesting if you're kind of interested in the topic. The one is, as I mentioned, The Shape of Actions by Harry Collins. Another one is Artificial Experts, again by Harry Collins. I don't have any time for questions because we are right at the beer break. So I don't want to be the one thing stopping you from having beer. But you can come and ask me questions in the break or in the hallway. And thank you very much.